अच्छा ठीक है, चलो नेटवर्क इशू हो सकता है, आ जाओ और ऋषभ सर को भी बोल दो आ जाएंगे। ठीक है। A very good evening to everyone present here. Today we have gathered here for a very special topic and very different topic, which is dispute resolution mechanism for MSME commerce business. I am Chandrika Lamba from business from a lawyer, a business outreach executive. With me, I have Damini Mohan, who has helped us in the research work of this webinar. And I would like to welcome our special guest, Mr. Rishabh Kapoor, who is a graduate from National Law School of India University, Bangalore, the premier law university of the country. Mr. Rishabh Kapoor has been practicing and handling cases independently with a result-oriented approach. He has now acquired over 5 years of professional experience in litigation, providing legal consultancy and advisory services. He regularly appears before the Supreme Court, Delhi High Court, District Court, and tribunals. And today, I would like to thank you, Rishabh sir, for coming, and you are going to give us insight on this topic. Without further ado, I would like to request, I would like to mention few points for the participants. I request all the participants to be on mute, and I request all the participants to share their questions or query within, if they have any in between the webinar or after that. You can write those questions in the chat box. Mr. Rishabh Kapoor would be happy to, you know, provide solution to your problems. And I request all the participants that in a minute or so, we'll be sharing a link for with you, which is attendance form. I request all the participants to fill that form. And now I would like Rishabh sir to take over the screen and proceed with the PPT.
Thank you so much. Thank you for having me here. The idea of this this discussion today is to have a broad outline on how MSMEs work and how and the new contours on with regards to the e-commerce business, especially the new Consumer Protection Act and the rules that have come about. So we thought that it would be a nice topic to discuss because this is relevant and also something which has recently come about and the developments are still happening. I've been told that most of the audiences, I mean, the benefit of this webinar would be to a lot of clients of lawyers who are businesses, who are small businesses. And for that purpose, of course, I also am aware that there are lawyers and law students who are also participants of the webinar, but it is for the benefit of the businesses that this webinar predominantly is being held. So I would try to keep it as less technical as possible. And I would also in between talk in Hindi so that for the benefit of the larger audience, that everybody, you know, gets the opportunity of understanding and gathering how the law around MSMEs and e-commerce works. So starting out, let's start with the MSMEs first. The MSMEs are governed by the MSME ED Act of 2006, so MSMEs really are micro, small and medium enterprises. The Act now defines what MSMEs are. And after the COVID pandemic, the government has, under the Atmanirbhar Abhiyan, has defined or redefined the definition of MSMEs and the limit for on which the MSMEs are defined has been increased. So, for example, earlier under Section 7(1)(a), a micro enterprise was So the enterprises are also defined in two manners. They are bifurcated. One are the service providers and the other are the providers of goods. So aap samaan bechte hain ya aapne services bechte hain. Dono MSMEs mein governed hain. Under 7(1)(a) earlier, the definition of micro enterprises was investment in plant and machinery, jo ki 5 लाख रुपए जो कि 25 लाख रुपए से कम थी. तो जिस भी कंपनी की इन्वेस्टमेंट अपनी प्लांट एंड मशीनरी में 25 लाख रुपए से कम है वो एक माइक्रो एंटरप्राइज माना जाता था. स्मॉल एंटरप्राइजेस सिमिलरली वाज 25 लाख टू 5 करोड़ एंड मीडियम एंटरप्राइज वाज 5 करोड़ टू 10 करोड़. तो ये डेफिनेशन था बिकॉज ऑफ कोविड एंड बिकॉज ऑफ टू प्रमोट एमएसएमईज इन इंडिया एंड टू हैव more and more businesses who can come under the definition of MSMEs, that has now been increased. Aur ab jo threshold hai, that is less than 1 crore of plant and machinery and equipment, either way. I forgot to mention, previously, jo maine aapko threshold bataya tha, wo goods ka tha. Services ka less than 10 lakh to 2 crores and 2 to 5 crores tha. So now that has, अब जो goods और services है वो एक common हो गया है, that has now been merged. और उसका जो threshold है, that is plant and machinery or equipment less than 1 crore plus a turnover of less than 5 crores would amount to a micro enterprise. Small enterprise has been changed to plant and machinery or equipment of between 10 crores and of less than 10 crore and turnover of 50 crores. Similarly for medium, it has gone up to be less than 50 crores as plant and machinery equipment and the turnover is under 250 crores. So that is really the definition. Now, what is the purpose of this act? The act bana kis liye? The act is liye bana hai taki jo small, medium scale businesses hain jisko hum pehle स्मॉल स्केल मीडियम स्केल इंडस्ट्री बोलते थे वो उसको डिफाइन करने के लिए और गवर्नमेंट को एक स्पेशल अप्रोच दी गई है कि स्मॉल मीडियम बिजनेसेस को माइक्रो बिजनेसेस को प्रमोट किया जाए और उनके बीच में जो कॉम्पिटिटिवनेस है उनका वो इंक्रीज किया जाए. उसके पर्पज के लिए ये एक्ट बना था 2006 के अंदर एंड देयर हैव बीन सर्टेन सम अमेंडमेंट्स देयर आफ्टर. The real purpose, of course, as I've discussed, enterprises. Now, what is an enterprise? Enterprise, agar hum micro, medium, or small or medium ko discuss kare, so enterprise kya hai? Enterprise kuch bhi ho sakta hai. So it could be a sole proprietorship, it could be a partnership, इट कुड बी अ कंपनी, इट कुड बी एन एलएलपी, इट कुड बी एन एचयूएफ, कोऑपरेटिव सोसाइटी, तो कुछ भी हो सकता है. तो ये काफी वाइड एंगल रखा गया है इसका कि हर तरह के बिजनेस या अदर अंडरटेकिंग्स को इसमें इंक्लूड किया जाए. देयर आफ्टर मैं दोबारा आऊंगा कि इसका जो डिस्प्यूट रिड्रेसल है वो कैसे हो सकता है. उसके अंदर हमें द डेफिनेशन ऑफ सप्लायर एंड द डेफिनेशन ऑफ बायर इज इम्पॉर्टेंट, वो मैं अभी डिस्कस करूंगा उसके बारे में. नाउ द एक्ट प्रोवाइड्स फॉर एस्टैब्लिशमेंट ऑफ अ बोर्ड जो कि प्रमोट करेगा. देन द फंक्शंस आर प्रोवाइडेड. क्लासिफिकेशन मैं ऑलरेडी आपको बता चुका हूँ कि किस हिसाब से क्लासिफिकेशन होगा. देन देयर इज अ रिक्वायरमेंट ऑफ मेमोरेंडम ऑफ माइक्रो स्मॉल एंड मीडियम एंटरप्राइजेस. तो आप कैसे बनेंगे, तो अपने आपको रजिस्टर करना इसकी एक रिक्वायरमेंट है अंडर सेक्शन 8. और उसके अंदर आपको एक अब जो गवर्नमेंट का जो नया एक नोटिफिकेशन आया है जो कि जुलाई 2020 के अंदर आया है, जिसके अंदर ये थ्रेशोल्ड भी इंक्रीज किया गया है. अंडर दैट द नोटिफिकेशन प्रोवाइड फॉर एन उद्योग आधार मेमोरेंडम. सो बेसिकली इट इज एन ऑनलाइन रजिस्ट्रेशन रिक्वायरमेंट, जिसके अंदर आपको उनकी वेबसाइट पर जाके यू कैन रजिस्टर योर सेल्फ एज एन MSME इन विच एवर कैटेगरी यू फॉल, आइदर माइक्रो मीडियम स्मॉल और मीडियम. And what you and it is like an Aadhaar card. So it is a one page document which gives you a registration that you are registered as an MSME. So if your requirements are with you, everything is available with you, you will get the registration right there. So there is no requirement of going to any offices or filing any documents. You will get your registration right there and then if your documents are available with you. Thereafter, the most important segment and the segment which we will discuss today is with regards to the dispute resolution mechanism for MSMEs. So, I must point out that this is under Chapter 5 of the Act, and it is only for micro and small enterprises. So, although the Act, jo Act MSME ka Act hai, jo micro small, okay, you can see on your screens also, it's micro, small, medium enterprises. Although the Act by itself considers all three enterprises, small, medium, and micro, small, and medium, but for the purpose of the benefit of the determination under Chapter 5, it is only limited to small and micro enterprises. So medium ka you will not be able to take benefit under this act. Uska bhi I will discuss how a medium enterprise can approach the courts for their dispute resolution. तो इसके अंदर अब क्या है कि इसमें सप्लायर और बायर का डेफिनेशन जरूरी है. सेक्शन 15 टॉक्स ऑफ लायबिलिटी ऑफ बायर टू मेक पेमेंट. इट इज व्हेन अ सप्लायर सप्लाइज एनी गुड्स और रेंडर्स एनी सर्विसेज, द बायर शैल मेक पेमेंट देयर ऑफ एंड बिफोर द डेट बिटवीन उसको पेमेंट करना है. तो बेसिकली जब भी कोई एक कोई एग्रीमेंट है दो एक सप्लायर और एक बायर के बीच में, तो और सप्लायर ने जब गुड्स सप्लाई कर दिए हैं बायर्स को या अपनी सर्विसेज प्रोवाइड कर दी हैं, तो उसके बाद बायर जो है वो उसको पेमेंट करना होगा. अब ये इसमें सप्लायर का क्या मतलब है, सप्लायर का मतलब जो है वो भी डिफाइंड है सेक्शन 2N के अंदर, जो बेसिकली बोलता है कि सप्लायर कोई माइक्रो या स्मॉल एंटरप्राइज है. अगेन इट डजंट इंक्लूड अ मीडियम enterprise, but it says a micro or small enterprise, इसने अपना memorandum authority में file कर रखा है as per section 8, जो मैंने already discuss कर लिया था कि memorandum क्या होता है. So that needs to be filed for the purpose of one becoming a supplier as per the definition under section 2N. And this also will include any company or corporate society, trust or body, किसी को भी include किया जाएगा जो कि या तो खुद गुड्स बनाते हैं, मैन्युफैक्चर करते हैं, या वो किसी और एमएसएमई का सॉरी किसी और माइक्रो या स्मॉल बिजनेस का गुड बनाया हुआ आगे बेचते हैं. सो आइदर यू आर अ माइक्रो और स्मॉल एंटरप्राइज योरसेल्फ, और यू कुड आल्सो बी अ सेलर ऑफ द गुड्स विच आर प्रिपेयर्ड बाय विच आर ओरिजिनली मैन्युफैक्चर्ड बाय अ माइक्रो और स्मॉल एंटरप्राइज. सो दैट ऑल्सो विल बी कवर्ड अंडर द डेफिनेशन. Now the act really talks of supplying of goods and services. So this will only cover the case where the aggrieved party जिसको हानि हुई है, जो वो पार्टी है, वो कौन जा सकता है? सिर्फ सप्लायर. सो बायर रियली यू कैन नॉट यूज द प्रोविजंस ऑफ द एक्ट टू योर बेनिफिट. इफ यू आर इफ फॉर एग्जांपल आपने किसी से गुड्स खरीदे हैं और आपने शुरू में पेमेंट कर दिया है और वो गुड्स नहीं आए या ठीक नहीं आए, तो मेरे हिसाब से एज पर माई अंडरस्टैंडिंग दैट वुड नॉट माइट नॉट बी कंसिडर्ड एज फार एज चैप्टर 5 ऑफ द एक्ट इज कंसर्न. नाउ अनदर इम्पॉर्टेंट थिंग दैट द एक्ट सेज इज फॉर एग्जाम्पल नाउ दैट यू एंड दिस इज वेरी कॉमन एंड स्पेशली इन ड्यूरिंग कोविड टाइम्स दैट बिजनेसेस हैव सप्लाइड देयर गुड्स और दे हैव सप्लाइड देयर सर्विसेज टू द बायर एंड नाउ द बायर हैज रिफ्यूज द बायर सेज दैट आई वुड मेक द पेमेंट बट रिफ्यूजेज टू मेक द पेमेंट और कीज डिलेइंग इट एंड दैट इज प्रीटी वेरी कॉमन दीज डेज बिकॉज ऑफ द फाइनेंशियल रिस्ट्रेंट्स ऑफ अ लॉट ऑफ बिजनेसेस ड्यूरिंग कोविड टाइम्स. सो इन दैट केस द बिगेस्ट प्रॉब्लम ऑफ स्पेशली माइक्रो एंड स्मॉल एंटरप्राइजेस विद रिगार्ड्स टू वर्किंग कैपिटल. नाउ दैट बिकम्स द होल रोटेशन ऑफ वर्किंग कैपिटल रियली कम्स टू अ हॉल्ट एंड दैट बिकम्स एन इशू इन द वर्किंग ऑन द डे टू डे बिजनेस ऑफ अ माइक्रो और स्मॉल एंटरप्राइज एंड दैट इज प्रोबेबली व्हाई दैट दिस दैट द एक्ट प्रोवाइड और अ स्पीडियर डिस्प्यूट रेजोल्यूशन मैकेनिज्म. इसमें क्या है कि अगर आपका पेमेंट कहीं से नहीं आ रहा है और आप उसमें टाइम पीरियड दिया गया है कि पेमेंट करने के, या तो जो पार्टी ने कॉन्ट्रैक्ट कर रखा है या अगर कॉन्ट्रैक्ट में कुछ नहीं लिखा है कि पेमेंट कितनी देर में आएगा, द टाइम फ्रेम इज नॉट प्रोवाइडेड, देन विद इन 15 डेज इफ देर इज नो कॉन्ट्रैक्ट और इफ देर इज अ कॉन्ट्रैक्ट अकॉर्डिंग टू द कॉन्ट्रैक्ट व्हाट द टाइम पीरियड इज द क्रेडिट टाइम पीरियड इज प्रोवाइडेड. But that time period cannot be more than 45 days. So generally now what people have done is that after the act has come into play, they have, because the customers of these enterprises are in lot of cases very large scale corporations. So wo dictate karte hain terms. They say that to overcome this 15 day period, they would say make the credit period of 6 months. तो जो एक्ट है वो कहता है कि अगर ऐसा 6 मंथ का भी फॉर एग्जांपल स्टिपुलेशन है दैट कैन नॉट एक्सीड 45 डेज, सो इट विल बी कंसीडर्ड दैट वाज 6 मंथ विल बी कंसीडर्ड 45 डेज. सो दैट इज द फर्स्ट थिंग. सेकंड इज सो व्हाट हैपेंस इफ देयर इज अ फेलियर. सो फॉर एग्जांपल इफ देयर इज अ टाइम पीरियड और लेट अस अज्यूम देयर इज नो टाइम पीरियड, सो 15 डेज के अंदर इफ यू प्रोवाइडेड अ गुड्स एंड सर्विसेज इन 15 डेज यू डू नॉट रिसीव योर पेमेंट from your customer, the buyer, then what do you do? Then as per section 16, there is a liability. Buyer ki liability hai ki wo 15 din ke baad jitna bhi time period tak payment nahi karta hai, usko us payment ka aur us amount ka jo payment hoga wo to karna hi hoga, principal amount, but along with interest. And the interest has been determined as 3 times the bank rate notified by RBI. So RBI ka jo bhi us time pe accident bank rate hoga, that will be considered, or 3 times of that will be the interest that will have to be paid. So for example, right now my understanding is that the bank rate of RBI is around 4.65%. So if you were to file or your liability of non-payment today would be 3 times that. So that will be around 13.9-14% would be your liability to pay in interest in addition to the principal that you have to refund. So that is under section 16. Then recovery, that koi bhi delay hoga uska recover karna padega. Section 18 is important, where it gives a reference to micro and small enterprises facilitation council. So now for example, dekhiye, agar aapke buyer ne aapko payment nahi kiya hai and he is supposed to make the payment 3 times, jo we already discussed kar chuke hain, but phir bhi payment nahi aa raha hai, to aap kya kar sakte hain? What you can do is that you can make a reference to Micro and Small Enterprises Facilitation Council. And every state government, हर state government एक ऐसा council, उसको एक या जितने भी council उसको अपने state के अंदर बनाने हैं और state government ही उसके rules भी notify करेगी. For example, Delhi government ने अपने state rules notify किए हैं, ऐसे ही हर government ने अपने अलग अलग state rules notify किए हैं जो mostly same हैं, but that also can be seen from the website of MSME, from the government of India, उनकी website पे हर स्टेट वाइज रूल्स भी दे रखे हैं. तो उसके अकॉर्डिंगली हर स्टेट ने जनरली अपने अपने फैसिलिटेशन काउंसिल्स बना रखे हैं। इनमें फैसिलिटेशन काउंसिल्स में क्या होता है, अगर आप यहाँ देख सकते हैं स्क्रीन पे, यहाँ पर पूरा बना रखा है कि आपको क्या प्रोसेस क्या है। बट जनरली द आइडिया ऑफ फैसिलिटेशन काउंसिल इज दैट फर्स्ट इज व्हेन यू अप्लाई फॉर इट, आपको एक कंसिलिएशन का अपॉर्चुनिटी मिलता है, कंसिलिएशन का समझौते का अपॉर्चुनिटी मिलता है, जिसके अंदर व्हेन यू फाइल योर क्लेम यू स्टेट दैट दिस वाज द एग्रीमेंट, दिस वाज द गुड सप्लाई, दिस इज द अमाउंट दैट वाज सपोज्ड टू बी पेड हैज नॉट बीन पेड, एंड इन दैट केस you give all these details and you file it with the council, and the council will ask the other party, they will issue a notice to the other party would have to come in there, and there would be a ek koshish ki jayegi, there will be an attempt to initiate a conciliation ki samjhota kisi tarah se kiya jaye, so that the matter doesn't go to court or arbitration, ki uska lamba jo bhi usme dispute hai wahi resolve ho jaye. अगर तो डिस्प्यूट रिजॉल्व होता है, इफ दैट हैपेंस देन दे लेट गो, देन बोथ पार्टीज साइन ऑन द डॉक्यूमेंट एंड देन द सेटलमेंट कम्स अबाउट। बट इफ इट डजंट देन देन इट आल्सो प्रोवाइड्स फॉर आर्बिट्रेशन। नाउ इट इज आई बिलीव अ वेलकम मूव इन विच जनरली क्या है कि आप अगर आपके पास अगर आप एक बिजनेस ओनर हैं, स्मॉल बिजनेस ओनर हैं, आप एक परचेज ऑर्डर आपको आता है, आप उसका पेमेंट कर, आप उसका गुड सप्लाई करते हैं, और परचेज ऑर्डर जनरली लिखा होता है कि सिविल कोर्ट्स विल हैव ज्यूरिसडिक्शन, और सिविल कोर्ट्स में फिर आप केस फाइल करें, उसका अपना जितना भी टाइम लगता है, एवरीबॉडी इज अवेयर दैट यू नो द सिविल कोर्ट्स आर हैव अ मैटर इन सिविल डिस्प्यूट, सिविल कोर्ट वुड टेक 5 years 7 years, लॉट ऑफ टाइम पीरियड इज वेस्टेड इन लिटिगेशन, एंड दैट मनी इज अ मनी दैट was supposed to come to you, or the money is the subject matter of the dispute is stuck. So for that purpose, because there is, since there is no arbitration proceeding or there is no arbitration agreement in your agreement or in your purchase order, the matter would have to be would have to be filed in a civil court. There is no other remedy available to the seller in this case. However, as per section 18 provides for a mechanism of arbitration, where they say that once a conciliation आपका अगर समझौता नहीं होता है, if the conciliation is not successful, then there is a method of arbitration which is provided, और वो arbitration और conciliation दोनों चीजें जो हैं वो जो ये council है ये क्या खुद कर सकती है या ये किसी third party को भी refer कर सकती है, तो वो उनकी power है करने के लिए। अब जो अगर arbitration में चला जाता है तो arbitration will be governed as if it was covered under the Arbitration Conciliation Act. Now, for the people who are not aware of what arbitration is, I will, in very nutshell, in brief, I will explain what arbitrations are. Arbitrations really are एक process होता है जो आप out of court dispute resolution होता है, जैसे जैसे judges court में बैठते हैं तो उसका जो time लगता है period dispute को adjudicate करने में, उसको बचाने के लिए और स्पीडियर प्रोसेस करने के लिए ये एक मैकेनिज्म है आर्बिट्रेशन, जिसके अंदर दोनों पार्टीज मिलके एक या मोर देन वन आर्बिट्रेटर्स जो आपस में वो समझौते से डिसाइड करते हैं, और वो आर्बिट्रेटर कुड बी एनीबडी, जनरल कुड बी अ रिटायर्ड जज, कुड बी अ लेट, कुड बी एन एडवोकेट, कुड बी अ टेक्निकल पर्सन एज वेल। तो वो पर्सन अपना अवार्ड दोनों पार्टीज को सुनता है, दोनों पार्टीज का जो जो प्रोसेस दिया गया है आर्बिट्रेशन एक्ट के अंदर उसको करता है, और वो जो भी जजमेंट उसका आता है वो कोर्ट मानती हैं, उसका सेम दर्जा दिया जाता है, इट इज कंसीडर्ड एज इफ अ कोर्ट हैज गिवन दैट जजमेंट, ऑल्दो उसका भी अपील के प्रोविजंस हैं, देन यू देयर इज अ प्रोविजन, अगर आपका कोई ऑर्डर चैलेंज करना है यू कैन गो अंडर सेक्शन 37 ऑफ द एक्ट, सेक्शन 34 है अगर आपको जो अवार्ड पास करता है आर्बिट्रेटर उसको चैलेंज करना है, सो ऑल ऑफ दोस थिंग्स आर कंसीडर्ड एज इफ इट वॉज एन आर्बिट्रेशन। सो that we can have a separate webinar for how arbitrations work, but nutshell में ये है कि आपका जो dispute होगा वो court में refer नहीं होगा, वो court adjudicate नहीं करेगा, वो एक arbitrator adjudicate करेगा, जो कि generally even as per the Arbitration Conciliation Act the time period provided there is within 1 year, यहाँ पर थोड़ा सा extension का provision भी है 6 months or so, but generally arbitrations are much quicker remedy than your courts. Of course, उसका जो कोर्ट फी होती है वो जनरली थोड़ी हाई होती है एज कम्पेयर टू द कोर्ट्स, बट दैट इज अनदर अनदर डिस्कशन। तो इसके अंदर क्या है कि आपका जो डिस्प्यूट है वो आर्बिट्रेशन में जाएगा। अब यहाँ क्वेश्चन आता है, व्हाट हैपेंस इफ देयर इज एन एग्जिस्टिंग आर्बिट्रेशन एग्रीमेंट, अगर दोनों पार्टी का जो एग्रीमेंट फॉर एग्जाम्पल हो रखा है या परचेज ऑर्डर है उसमें मेंशन है कि देयर इज दैट द डिस्प्यूट विल बी रेफर टू आर्बिट्रेशन, देन व्हाट डू यू डू? देन द कोर्ट्स हैव हेल्ड दैट इन दैट केस द प्रोसेस अंडर द एमएसएमई एक्ट, द प्रोसेस अंडर सेक्शन 18 विल have an overriding effect over the arbitration. तो अगर आपका अगर आप सेलर हैं, आपके पास ऑप्शन है कि आप या तो यहाँ पे MSME एक्ट में जाएं या आप आर्बिट्रेशन को भी जो आपके एग्रीमेंट में मैंशनड है आप उस एग्रीमेंट आर्बिट्रेशन को भी आपको इन्वोक करना है, तो इट इज अ चॉइस दैट यू हैव, यू कैन डू आइदर, बट द अदर पार्टी कैन नॉट देन सक्सेसफुली आर्ग्यू कि हमारा ऑलरेडी आर्बिट्रेशन एग्रीमेंट है तो उसी में ही जाना पड़ेगा एज पर द एग्रीमेंट एंड यू कांट कम अंडर सेक्शन 18। द कोर्ट्स हैव हेल्ड दैट इट इज अ चॉइस दैट यू हैव, यू कैन आइदर गो अंडर सेक्शन 18 और यू कैन गो अंडर द आर्बिट्रेशन एक्ट एज पर योर आर्बिट्रेशन एग्रीमेंट, बट वंस यूव गॉन अंडर यू कम ह्योर अंडर सेक्शन 18 देन यू कैन नॉट देन रेफर देन गो बैक टू योर आर्बिट्रेशन अंडर द आर्बिट्रेशन एग्रीमेंट। Then the next is with regards to this another important provision with regards to what happens when, for example, you have a decree or a judgment in your favor and the arbitrator passes an award. आपके favor में arbitrator ने award कर दिया. For example, arbitrator ने बोला कि हाँ आपको 1 करोड़ रुपया देना है, आपके जिस buyer है उसने आपको payment करना है और आपको payment करना पड़ेगा इसी हिसाब से उसमें mentioned है. अब the other party generally and that is generally the case that the other party will challenge it, वो उसका appeal file करती है. एक तो जो आपका appeal इसमें file होगा that would be under section 34 of the arbitration act. तो उसका जो जो उसका scope है that is very limited. So उसके अंदर arbitration act में provide किया जाता है कि आपका जो जो भी court होगा and depending on the pecuniary jurisdiction the court generally it is a district court but in states where the high court has the original jurisdiction, so uska 2 crore ke upar agar hua for example to delhi mein aapko aap directly high court mein file kar sakte hain. usme kya hota hai ki as compared to a civil court agar aapka ek case civil court mein chal raha hota for example agar aapke civil judge ne judgment diya hai to aap usko challenge karenge before the adj aapka district judge district judge ke court mein aap usko challenge karte hain appeal file karte hain then the district judge in the first appeal will reappreciate evidence, wo पूरा केस दोबारा से अप्रिशिएट करेगा, फैक्ट्स देखेगा, पूरा अप्रिशिएट करेगा एविडेंस कि क्या क्या एविडेंस है, कहाँ अगर कोई चैलेंज है तो क्या चैलेंज हुआ है, जज ने कहाँ गलती की है, तो वो सब जो फर्स्ट अपीलेट कोर्ट है वो सब देखता है. बट इन द केस ऑफ सेक्शन 34 अगर आप आर्बिट्रेशन में चैलेंज होता है तो द स्कोप ऑफ चैलेंज इज वेरी वेरी नैरो. उसके जज सिर्फ ये देखेंगे कि आपका जो जजमेंट था वो अगर अगर तो एविडेंस का एप्रिसिएशन है कि इन्होंने इस अगर ये 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 एविडेंस को ठीक से देखा है या नहीं देखा है, या एक पॉसिबिलिटी है कि जो जज जो आर्बिट्रेटर ने अवार्ड दिया है वो सही है या उसका कोई ऐसा क्रिटिकल लीगल मिस्टेक नहीं किया गया या ऐसा कुछ नहीं है कि जिसको देख के लगे कि ये बिल्कुल गलत सरासर गलत है. इन दैट केस कोर्ट्स जनरली डू नॉट इंटरफेयर, वो इंटरफेयर उसमें नहीं करेंगे. So that is something that section 13, 34 really helps in. That it narrows down the scope of the intervention of the appellate court. Secondly, under section 19, what section 19 of the MSME MED Act says is that if that there is a challenge which is filed, so if you for example file a section 34, in that case you will have to deposit with the court 75% of the award which has been passed. For example, the example that I gave that if the arbitrator gives a judgment, for example, that the buyer needs to be the seller needs to be paid 1 crore by the buyer. In that case, the seller will necessarily have to deposit 75 lakhs with the court. So with the court where the appeal has been filed. Where the section 34 is filed, that will have to be first deposited. अगर आप deposit नहीं करते हैं तो courts ने बोला है कि that will not be taken admitted. तो उसको वो courts एडमिट नहीं करेंगी अनलेस यू फाइल 75 लाख और 75% व्हाटएवर द केस मे बी इन द कोर्ट. और वो कोर्ट अंडर इट्स डिस्क्रेशन, उनकी इनका डिस्क्रेशन है कि वो दे कैन इवन गिव गिव आउट अ पार्ट ऑफ दैट 75% टू द बायर डायरेक्टली. कि वो बोलेंगे कि आउट ऑफ 75% फॉर एग्जाम्पल हम इसका कुछ हिस्सा आपको बायर को हम ऑलरेडी दे रहे हैं ताकि सो दैट इवन ड्यूरिंग द कोर्स ऑफ द अपील द बायर एटलीस्ट गेट्स सम पोर्शन ऑफ द मनी इन हिज हैंड which he can of course utilize in his day-to-day business. So that ऐसा ना हो कि जब तक बाद में dispute का appeal का judgment आए या उसका उसका resolution हो तब तक वो out of pocket उनके expenses होते रहे, जो litigation है उसका खर्चा या जो business का खर्चा है, तो वो भी court के पास power है, वो कुछ उसका हिस्सा और कुछ भी condition लगा के वो दे सकता है. Thereafter there is the facilitation council रिक्वायरमेंट. हाँ, तो एक और रिक्वायरमेंट सेक्शन 22 में ये भी है कि अगर आप आपका कोई भी बायर जो आप जिससे आप गुड्स खरीदते हैं वो अगर MSME है तो यू विल हैव टू मेंशन इन योर एनुअल स्टेट ऑफ अकाउंट्स एनुअल स्टेटमेंट ऑफ अकाउंट्स सेइंग कि मेरे ये मैंने पेमेंट्स इस MSME को बनती थी, मैंने इतनी की है, इसमें मेरे को इंटरेस्ट पढ़ा कि नहीं पढ़ा, अगर पढ़ा है तो मैंने कितना दिया है, किस हिसाब से दिया है, अगर मैंने नहीं दिया है तो मैंने कितना पेमेंट बनता है जो मैंने अभी तक नहीं दिया है, क्या बैलेंस है, क्या बकाया है, ये सब को मेंशन करना होगा इन बुक्स ऑफ अकाउंट्स. दैट आई बिलीव इज अनदर इंसेंटिव और डिसइंसेंटिव फॉर योर बायर्स ऑफ एन MSME कंपनी, जो कि उनको अपने बुक्स पर दिखाना पड़ेगा, तो इसलिए वो उसका पेमेंट जनरली कर दें ताकि उनको ये दिखाना ना पड़े और इसका कोई एडवर्स उसका इफेक्ट ना पड़े. और इसमें कोई पेनल्टीज दी गई हैं एंड द ज्यूरिसडिक्शन इज इम्पॉर्टेंट. तो अब आप इसको कहाँ फाइल करते हैं? जनरली अगर आपको इफ यू हैव टू फाइल अ सिविल सूट, फॉर एग्जांपल आप दिल्ली में बैठे हैं और आपका जो जो बायर है जिसको आप गुड्स भेज रहे हैं ही फॉर एग्जाम्पल सिट्स इन कलकत्ता, सो नाउ जनरली द कोर्ट्स विल लुक एट सिविल कोर्ट्स में ये दिया गया है कि वो
यहाँ का कॉज ऑफ एक्शन. सॉरी टू इंटरप्ट ऋषभ सर, वन ऑफ द पार्टिसिपेंट विजिबल हैज आस्क्ड यू टू स्पीक इन इंग्लिश एज हैज रिक्वेस्टेड यू टू स्पीक.
ओके, सो आई एम डूइंग इट इन बोथ लैंग्वेजेस. आई वाज टोल्ड दैट देयर आर पीपल हु वुड बी मोर कंफर्टेबल इन हिंदी, सो आई विल ट्राई टू फॉर इंपॉर्टेंट एस्पेक्ट्स आई विल ट्राई टू say it in English as well as repeat in Hindi for the benefit of all. Yeah. So the jurisdiction is very important. So now what is the jurisdiction of court generally in a civil suit, for example, if this act was not in place. Now for an MSME, what would an MSME do? An MSME would have to file a civil suit against the buyer. Now the buyer, for example, as I've spoken, is sitting in Calcutta and you are sitting in Delhi. So you will have to end maybe you've dispatched the goods from say a factory in Haridwar. So now there is no cause of action that has arisen in Delhi. So you will have to necessarily either file it in Haridwar where the goods have been supplied from, or the cause of action will be the place of business of the defendant, which would be in Calcutta. So aapko jo bhi iska procedure, whatever the procedure under the MSME Act, you will have to if there were no MSME Act, then you would have to file a civil suit either in Haridwar or in Calcutta. And similarly for services, if you're given your services in another city, you will have to necessarily then the jurisdiction of courts as per CPC, section 16-20 of the CPC would be in that particular city. So MSME Act provides you for a benefit, which is that jurisdiction becomes the state or the city, depending on where the council is situated in the state, you can file it there itself, and the other party will have to report to that particular authority. So that I believe is another welcome step, and that step I think is also now been incorporated in the new Consumer Protection Act, about which we'll discuss later. जनरली की प्रॉब्लम जिसको जो भी प्लेंटिफ है, जिसको भी ग्रीवेंस है, दैट पार्टी शुड नॉट बी इनकन्वीनियंस्ड, दैट मुझे इसका एक डिसइंसेंटिव नहीं होना चाहिए कि मेरे को दूसरे सिटी में जाना है, आई हैव टू हायर लॉयर देयर, आई हैव टू गो माय सेल्फ पर्सनली. ऑल ऑफ दोस थिंग्स आर ऑब्विएटेड विद दिस एमएसएमई एक्ट, वेयर द ज्यूरिसडिक्शन इज प्रोवाइडेड इन द सिटी और द स्टेट वेयर यू आर लिविंग इन. सो आई बिलीव दैट इज द लॉन्ग एंड शॉर्ट ऑफ हाउ एमएसएमईज वर्क्स. एंड नाउ आई हैड डिस्कस्ड हाउ व्हाट हैपेंस इन केस यू आर अ मीडियम एंटरप्राइज. A medium enterprise unfortunately will not get the benefit of the adjudication under the MSME Act as per the process provided in Chapter 5. You will have to then approach the normal civil courts. But in that case as well, now there is the Commercial Courts Act which has come in, the Commercial Courts Act of 2015, which I believe is another welcome legislation in which it also provides, of course, the civil courts will have jurisdiction, but that provides for special courts, which are commercial courts in provided in each district. Those will then have the power to adjudicate upon your case. There is the timelines are stricter. There are various additional requirements that one has to do. So, जो time waste या time लगता था या जो भी tactics defendants generally use करते थे to delay the proceedings, that also is more difficult under the new Commercial Courts Act. And the Commercial Court Act also interestingly has a similar provision of conciliation and then adjudication. Of course, the adjudication is there by the courts. Here it is by arbitration, but there is also a mandatory requirement of conciliation there as well. That's called the pre-adjudication mediation process, in which you have to mandatorily file before the for mediation or conciliation, and if that fails, only then you can get a report from the authority and then go to the court and say and ask for the adjudication of your disputes. So I believe that is something that is that one can use. I mean, there are mediums entrepreneur or other media enterprise can use and go to the commercial courts and file a dispute there. Of course, if they already has a an arbitration agreement, then he can refer the dispute to the to arbitration to the arbitration to the tribunal or the sole arbitrator, whatever the case may be. Yes, so this is the conciliation and arbitration that we were discussing. Section 15 provides for liability, 17 provides for recovery amount, 18 provides for reference and setting aside the award or the decree. Of course, there is no decree, but that word is redundant because an arbitrator would pass an award and not a decree, but that should be deemed to be a an award of the arbitrator only. The development with regards to online business, so while we were discussing as to what the topic should be, I also suggested that we should put in a small segment with regards to online business. And I say that because very recently the central government has come up with these rules, which are the Consumer Protection E-Commerce Rules of 2020, and they had come out only late last month. So July के end में ये rules आए हैं. The idea essentially is, so earlier under the Consumer Protection Act, the earlier act was 1986. There were various issues with that. First of all, I had discussed earlier, उसमें the jurisdiction was a big problem. The consumer had to go to the registered office of the opposite party against which he intended to file. So that was a big disincentive. Secondly, they were I mean, because it was 1986, e-commerce had not come in, so there was really no discussion with regards to what happens if a dispute is online dispute. So that, I think all of that has now been culminated, and it's come to and a new act has come out, which is the Consumer Protection Act 2019. See, e-commerce, the business really is no different from a normal business as far as the law is concerned. It also will be governed by the Indian Contract Act, जैसे कि normal आपके contracts govern होते हैं Indian Contract Act के अंदर, ये भी govern होगा. Just that the IP Act of 2000 gives an addition, a backing, or it approves that there could be e-contracts also. So that is, I think, the only difference between the normal traditional contracts that we have and the contracts entered into under online, I mean, as e-commerce contracts. this segment is made keeping in mind the requirements of businesses who sell their goods online. So, for example, there is a merchant who sells his electronics or any other goods online on Amazon, Flipkart, etc. So, what are the rules regarding that, and in and what does the Consumer Protection E-commerce Rules of 2020? What does that bring in for you? अगर आपके किसी कस्टमर को कोई इश्यू है तो वो आपके अगेंस्ट इन रूल्स के अंडर आपके खिलाफ जा सकता है. उसमें इसे बताया गया है कि व्हाट आर द एंड व्हाट आर द वेज वेयर जो भी आपका बिजनेस है अगर आप उसमें कोई अनफेयर ट्रेड प्रैक्टिस कर रहे हैं या व्हाट आर द रिक्वायरमेंट्स अंडर द रूल्स कि आपको क्या क्या चीजें पता होनी चाहिए, व्हाट यू शुड बी अवेयर. सो दैट इज व्हाट वी विल डिस्कस हियर. Generally speaking, the rules govern three kind of entities. One is the e-commerce entity. So e-commerce entities generally are these platforms like Flipkart, like your Amazon. So all of these entities, yeah, Click, Tata Click, hai. So all of these entities which are platforms really, jahan pe, which is really a marketplace. So so earlier what they would do is they would take the benefit of the IT Act, Section 78, if I'm not mistaken, and they say that we are intermediaries. Hum to ek platform hai, we are an intermediary and we do not have any liability of our own. So it is like you going to a shopping mall and going to a mall and buying say goods from a particular store. Then they say that if a good is faulty, then you can't really sue the mall, but you have to sue the particular business or the particular either the shop owner or the business, but you can't sue the mall for it. So that is the benefit that or the safeguard that has been provided to an intermediary, and that intermediary I mean generally has been used by Facebook, by Amazon, by Twitter, all of these these intermediaries, and they said that we by ourselves it is a platform in which people share their ideas, or if people are putting something, we are only an intermediary. We bring in the buyer and the supplier together, or the buyer and the seller together, and we are only a platform or a marketplace, and we are nothing else. But these guidelines of the Act, the Consumer Protection Act, specifically provides for liability of these e-commerce entities also. So they say that no, I'm sorry, because people have this faith in you, or they come. They see your brand on Amazon is a big marketplace, and Amazon should also, if it is benefiting or if it is taking advantage, if it is profiteering from this business, it should also have some liability. So that one, that people have this faith in e-commerce. Generally, it is considered riskier. So, uska faith lagane ke liye and to promote e-commerce, this has now come about. So the three entities that these rules discuss, one is an e-commerce entity, as I said, these platforms like Amazon, Flipkart, or the other is the inventory e-commerce entity. Inventory e-commerce entity is standalone websites. So, for example, you will have websites of each particular company. You will have a website, say, for example, Zara will have its own website. H&M will have its own website, apart from, of course, selling their goods on these e-commerce platforms, but they will have their standalone websites also. So that is the second entity that it discusses. And third is the seller that they talk of. The seller is the normal retailer who puts up his goods online. So the liability of an e-commerce entity, liability of as you can see on your screen, Rule 4 talks of duties and liability of e-commerce entities, of marketplaces, of the sellers. E-commerce entities, all three of them, marketplace is one, seller is the second, and the e-commerce entity is the third one. Now duties, I will not go into much detail about the duties of e-commerce entities, because I believe the beneficiary of these webinars will not be, although I'm hopeful, but I don't think Amazon would be watching this webinar. It is mostly the sellers that would want to understand what are their liabilities under the rules. But generally for Amazon, I have discussed that they might not be able to use their protection under the as an intermediary in the IT Act. They will have to appoint a nodal officer. That his contact number should be there. He should be in India. So generally all these marketplaces are not based out of India. So they say that we don't have a presence in India. So now they necessarily will have to have presence in India. They will have to have a designated functionary, a designated person who is in India. Then an adequate grievance redressal mechanism has to be provided. The grievance officer needs to be demarcated within 48 hours. If there is any complaint, any grievance, then that has to be acknowledged and responded to. They also have to after. I think this is the result of the China issue, that you have to also mention the name and details of the owner from where the goods are coming from. So that also is a requirement under the new rules. They have been told not to manipulate price of goods, discriminate between consumers. So all of that, and their liabilities are provided for. More importantly, the duties of sellers on marketplace. So now this is the normal merchant that we discussed. Well, it could be an MSME also. Now it says that you should not adopt any unfair trade practice. There should not be any false representation. If you are a seller, you should not represent yourself as a consumer and post reviews or give any falsely represent karke apne aapko ki generally the owners, the sellers themselves represent themselves as consumers and write good reviews. So that you should not do. You should not refuse to take back goods if they are defected, deficient, spurious. Of course, you get the benefit of force majeure. Agar kuch delivery late ho gayi, koi reason hai, to aap uska benefit le sakte hain. You should have a prior written contract with the e-commerce entity. You should also, in addition to the Amazon, and this is important, you should also have a separate grievance redressal officer. So Amazon itself, it's not enough that Amazon has a grievance officer. Every seller will have his own grievance officer, and he will also respond within 48 hours to any grievance that has been issued. Thereafter, you have to provide the e-commerce with your legal name, principal, demographic address of headquarters, your all details, GST, GSTN, and PAN details. You have to ensure that your advertisements are not false, not misplaced. अपने सब एंटिटी को सब इंफॉर्मेशन यू हैव टू प्रोवाइड ऑन द वेबसाइट ऑन द ई प्लेटफॉर्म सेइंग द कॉन्ट्रैक्चुअल इंफॉर्मेशन रिक्वायर्ड टू बी डिस्क्लोज बाय लॉ द टोटल प्राइस इन सिंगल फीचर ऑफ गुड्स विद ब्रेकअप आपको यू हैव टू ब्रेक इट डाउन कि ये इसका प्राइस है ये टैक्सेस हैं यू हैव टू गिव ऑल द नेसेसरी मैंडेटरी एप्लीकेबल लॉस का जो आपको पालन करना होगा यू हैव टू गिव द एक्सपायरी डेट ऑफ गुड्स वेयर एवर एप्लीकेबल all relevant details will have to be given with regards to country of origin, jahan se product ka bahar se aa raha hai, name, designation of the grievance officer, details of importer, accurate information related terms of exchange, return, refund policy, and any guarantees and warranties that are applicable, and your details related to delivery and shipment of goods. So that essentially is with regards to an individual or a seller who's selling. Then it comes up the e-commerce entities. That they in the standalone companies that are discussed, about, for example, as Zara is selling in its own website, they will also have to abide by these requirements. Then it says that any contravention of these rules will be discussed as per the Consumer Protection Act. So, Consumer Protection Act ki jo bhi penalties, jo bhi requirement hogi, wo bhi aap kar sakte hain. To kisi ko agar aapke khilaf iske bawajood bhi complaint file karni, so they will have to then go under the Consumer Protection Act. Jo bhi remedies hain before the district forum, state forum. National forum, they can then choose their remedy and then proceed. So I believe that is the contravention of rules are as per the provisions of the Consumer Protection Act. So I believe that is it from my side with regards to what my discussion was. If you have any questions, I believe we can have them here. Chandrika.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
So, sir, thank you so much for the insight. So, we have questions right now. Also, I request all the audiences to share their questions with us so that we can ask in the live Q&A session and Mr. Rishabh Kapoor will be answering them. Also, I request all the participants to fill the form for the attendance purpose. So, the first question we have right now is... from Pawan, what is the remedy for the issue of delayed payment to MSME in India and in general, any suggestion that is legal forum available for this?
No, sorry, I didn't understand the question.
I'll tell you the question again. What is the remedy for the issues of delayed payment to MSME in India?
Right. So again, that is what we discussed in my presentation as well. So the MSME Act, and that is again, I reiterate, with only with regards to the micro and small enterprises, they can go to the procedure provided under Chapter 5, delayed payments to micro and small enterprises. So they can go under that, and then they have to be gone into. So that I think we've discussed thoroughly in our in my talk that I just taken place.
Okay, yeah. In the presentation. I hope Pawan sir has answered your question. If you have any further question to it, please let us know in the chat box.
I think he also asked for there was only a second part to his question as well.
Yeah, so he was asking about any general suggestion for free legal aid or forum if available.
Free legal aid. Free legal aid, we have our legal aid authorities in every city, in every state has its own separate legal aid authority. For example, in Delhi, we have the DLSA, Delhi Legal State Authority. It has a forum in every district court, every high court, even the Supreme Court provides for it. So if you fall under the criteria, for example, the criteria is for women have a criteria, the old age, the elderly have a criteria, there is a pecuniary requirement also. So if you fall under that, if your income is below that, so that also is another criteria. So if you fall under that criteria, then definitely you can legal aid could be provided, and these matters could be filed under those provisions. So with the benefit of free legal aid that could be given to you, of course, definitely.
Okay. So the next question is a generic one. What is MSME and what are the benefits of MSME registration?
Yeah, so we've just dealt with it. Apart from the MSME, we've already discussed the benefits of registration. One, I think, is with regards to the dispute redressal that we discussed already. So you get the benefit of that. Apart from that, there are other incentives. It's not legal, but we can briefly discuss it. Yeah, you can. So there are in the new, I think the notification of July 2020, if I'm not mistaken, you get collateral free loans advances for MSMEs are given at a discounted price. Then I believe there are other benefits with regards to, I will have to have a look at the regulations, but I mean the notification, but the notification provides for it. I mean, apart from that, there is MSMEs have their separate board, a national board for micro, small and medium enterprises has come into effect. So that has its headquarters in Delhi that examines the factors affecting the promotion of MSMEs. It makes recommendations to the government, advises the central government. That in general, that's probably are the additional benefits of being an MSME, but directly affecting MSME, I think, is the new one is the dispute redressal, and secondly is the collateral free loans that you get. I believe there are a couple of others that notification will have all the details. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, sir, for the information. The next question we have is: can a general shop owner register in MSME?
Yes, so a shop owner, again, depends on if it meets the criteria, but I'm sure if every business would at least meet the criteria of a micro enterprise. So a general shop owner, if he falls under, depending on what his turnover is and what his plant and machinery or any other equipment that he has. So for example, a micro, as we've discussed, it is less than 1 crore. If your plant and machinery or equipment is less than 1 crore and your turnover is less than 5 crores a year, you can register yourself as a micro enterprise. There is in the entity, there is no bar on the entities, so a proprietorship, a partnership, an LLP, a company, even a cooperative society can also register as an MSME. So I think that, of course, definitely a regular shopkeeper also can register himself as an MSME.
Okay. So the next question we have is, what is the penalty for the contravention of the rule?
Which rules are we discussing?
There's nothing else written in this question.
Is he talking about the consumer protection rules, the e-commerce rules?
I request Subhash to complete the question as need specifications. He needs some specifications to the questions. So yeah. The next question is the dispute resolution process same under MSME Act and Arbitration Conciliation Act?
Yes. So as we've discussed earlier, if the conciliation fails as per Section 17 of the MSME Act, if the conciliation between the parties fails, then yes, the matter is referred to arbitration, and that would be considered as any other arbitration under the Arbitration Act. So after that threshold of conciliation gets over, I mean, after that, if that fails, then it is referred to arbitration, and that the arbitration would be would continue or would be effected as if it was an arbitration under an arbitration agreement between the parties, and it will be governed by the Arbitration Conciliation Act. Yes.
So the next question we have is from Neelam. What are the liabilities of marketplace e-commerce entities?
The liabilities will come under the Consumer Protection Act. So the rules provide for the contravention. It provides for your duties and liabilities. But in terms of the pecuniary liability, that you'll have to go under the Consumer Protection Act. So if you're found to be negligent, if you're found to have unfair trade practices, to be indulging in such practices, then as per the Consumer Protection Act, you will the penalties will be awarded.
Okay. The next question is from a student. What is the difference between arbitration and conciliation?
Okay, so they are both alternate dispute resolution mechanisms. They are both both fall out of the traditional structure of a courtroom. A conciliation really is a process where the two parties meet outside of a courtroom, where legality really is not discussed, but there is there could be mediators sitting there. A mediator could sit both parties down and discuss the pros and cons, and they could probably come to a mutual understanding, or there is a compromise that comes about. So that is really the conciliation, what we call it, an out of court settlement, generally in common parlance, or we say samjhota ho gaya do parties, they compromised. So that is what a conciliation is. An arbitration is really the full fledged adjudication mechanism, where it is the adjudication in a courtroom, but the rules of CPC per se do not apply. The rules of Arbitration Conciliation Act would apply. There will be an arbitrator who would not be sitting in the courtroom, would not be a judge in the technical sense. So that is generally it is considered to be a faster dispute redressal mechanism. So that is really the difference between the two. Of course, while you are in arbitration, you can again still go back to mediation. Parties can then still compromise while a dispute is being adjudicated by the court or by an arbitrator. So that essentially is the difference between the two.
The next question we have is from Vijayvel. What are the defenses? What are the defenses available to set aside the arbitration award?
Again, so that I discussed in general. The defenses are provided under Section 34 of the Arbitration Act. It is very, very narrow. The jurisdiction of the court is not to reappreciate evidence. It will only consider questions which it thinks which go to the root of the dispute, something which maybe shocks the conscience of the court, something which is against public policy. So it is very narrow. So there is an entire jurisprudence under Section 34, and there have been various amendments to section. So that probably could be a separate discussion altogether. I mean, that could take another hour or so if we get into the details of Section 34. But yes, the defenses available are very, very limited to an appellant under Section 34.
Okay. There's a question like, is registration necessary for my e-commerce business? Ankita has asked this question.
Registration with what?
Is registration of my e-commerce business necessary?
No, so registration with MSME or registration to have an e-commerce business?
To have an e-commerce business.
Because so as per the, if I'm, unless I'm, I'd be happy to be corrected, but I believe that the only requirement under the regulations are that you need to have an agreement with the e-commerce website, and then you have your the normal business requirements of having a GSTIN and your PAN card. So I think apart from that, unless there is any other requirement specifically pertaining to your industry or your business, I think there is no other requirement. Of course, you can also register as an MSME under Section 8. But I think there is no specific requirement as such to become, to have an e-commerce business.
Okay. Sir Pulkit has asked, sir, what are, according to your point of view, that the new consumer protection e-commerce rules, does it put an extra burden on the e-commerce seller?
See, it does, and I think rightly so. So I think if you look at the requirement under law generally, I think these requirements were already in place. I mean, even if we were to go under the previous Consumer Protection Act, if I were to say file a complaint against a seller on e-commerce, the requirements of not indulging in unfair trade practice, for example, would still apply. So I think the only additional requirement or additional liability that these current rules provide is to have a prior written contract with the e-commerce entity. I think the most important is to have a grievance officer for such consumer grievances. So I think that is something that one would have to look into how that pans out. I understand that if it's a seller is sole proprietor, he himself could be that grievance officer. There is no such requirement that it has to be, unless you, as long as you provide a person who is a grievance officer and you give his details and phone number and email address, I think that should suffice. So there is, I think the idea of having these rules were mostly to include the platforms like Amazon and Flipkart. So it is mostly to impute liability on them more than on the seller, because the seller already was liable under the previous regime as well. The only difference I can see now is having a grievance officer for consumer grievances and all of that. So I think that is and not falsely representing itself as a consumer and posting reviews and giving the details of, anyway, you are supposed to give the details of the goods, and you have the refund policy in place with these e-commerce websites. So I think that there is no additional liability that I see which is being imputed on a seller or e-commerce.
Okay. So the next question we have is from Gaurav Mehta. Yeah. What if e-commerce entity is not registered under MSME? Will this act bound e-commerce entity to settle the dispute?
No. So there is no, will it bound the e-commerce entity to settle the dispute? So basically the e-commerce entity is in this case the it cannot be the buyer, right? So only the seller can proceed against it. So I believe the question seems to be slightly misplaced.
Okay, Gaurav Mehta, I request you, if you want to ask this question personally to Rishabh, sir, I request you to please unmute yourself and ask the question. The next question we have is from Vijay Will. I think he has asked a previous question, what are the defense available to set aside the arbitration award? And now to that question, probably he has asked another question. Does Evidence Act apply to arbitration proceedings?
See, we will have to get into, that is not the purview of this this talk right now that we have.
Okay.
So we will get into, we can have a separate one to discuss arbitrations and the applicability of CBC and Evidence Act in that. But generally, to answer your questions, yeah, the arbitrator will have has the power to decide the procedures. So he may or he may not proceed as per the Evidence Act. That is the prerogative of the arbitrator to get involved. So he has that liberty to dictate the procedure of his arbitration. And if the parties agree to that the requirement under the Evidence Act can also be wished aside for the purpose of the arbitration determination.
Okay, I request Vijayal that in the previous slide, sir has shared his contact detail. I think Rishabh sir, you will be more than happy if he can write his queries to you through email, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So I request Vijayan to, you can write down your detailed query and mail it to sir. The next question we have is from Shrishta. She is asking, what are the benefits of getting registered under MSME Act over Companies Act?
No, so there is, you will have to appreciate that the requirements of, if you are a company, you will have to get incorporated and registered under the Companies Act anyway. So an MSME Act is only, so that is an added incentive or the added benefit that you're getting by becoming an MSME. So if you're a company, you cannot circumvent the procedure of complying with the requirements under the Companies Act. So it is only that the MSME Act provides a seller or an MSME under the MSME Act can, company is only one such entity. So as I said earlier, a proprietor and a partnership, any association of persons, LLP, company, any entity could be an MSME. So a company is only one such entity, but the company or the LLP for that matter will have to comply with the requirements under their respective regime. So a company will have to comply with the requirements of the Companies Act, LLP will have to require be under registered under the LLP Act, and so on and so forth. So there is no overlap between the two. There is no either or. You will have to do both. I mean, there is no mandatory requirement of the MSME Act, but you will have to necessarily be registered under the Companies Act if you want to become a company.
Okay, I request all the participants to please fill the form of attendance. The next question will be, due to time constraint, we'll be closing this webinar shortly. So I'll be taking a few more questions, sir, with your permission.
Yeah, sure.
Okay. The next question is it necessary for an e-commerce business to have a registered geographical address? I think very logical one, because it's a virtual platform.
And e-commerce seller to have a...
Should I repeat the question, sir?
Yes.
So the question is, is it necessary for an e-commerce business to have a registered geographical address?
Yes. So there is a requirement. So I mean, if you are selling any goods, you will be selling it from a geographical area, and it will be it is necessary. It is mandatory under the rules for you to provide your geographical area. It could be anywhere. I mean, you are operating from specifically. I can see rule 6-5. Yeah, 6-4D says that any seller offering goods or services through e-commerce marketplace shall provide to the e-commerce entity its legal name, principal geographical address of its headquarters and all branches, name and detail of its website, email address, customer care details, etc. So that is a requirement, yes. That's a mandatory requirement that wherever you're operating from, that has to be provided.
Okay, so there is a question, what are the challenges faced by MSMEs in getting credit?
See, that is really a non-legal question. But I think the general problem that has been being faced by small enterprises is having a collateral. So if you don't have a decent collateral, the banks do not are hesitant in giving you such loans. So I think the new notification that has come about the and under the Atmanirbhar plan of the government, they've provided for collateral free loans to be disbursed. I think the government itself becomes a, if I'm not wrong, becomes a guarantor in such cases. So I think that also to, I am not sure of what the implementation is on the ground level, but I think that could really help in the MSMEs getting credit.
Okay, there's a question to you, since you are a lawyer. Can a law firm register, can a law firm be registered under the MSME Act? If not, why?
I think it's a good question. If you ask me, I think the requirements under under section, I think the requirements under an enterprise under the definition of enterprise under 2E provides for, as far as service provider is concerned, provides for any industrial undertaking or a business concern or any other establishment engaged in providing or rendering of any service or services. So I think if you consider this definition, a law firm, of course, cannot be a business concern, but it could be any other establishment by whatever name called engaged in providing or rendering of any services. So if you ask me, I think there should not be a problem in law firms registering themselves as MSMEs.
So I was saying by definition it says that any firm providing services.
It says that, but the only thing is, I mean, it is a business concern. So, I mean, a lawyer really is not performing a business. So if that could be the only hindrance which could come about. But I think there was a PIL filed in the Delhi High Court which said that lawyers should also be included in the benefits of MSMEs. That was dismissed. But I think the new notification of the government includes doctors, lawyers, architects, all professionals as well under the ambit of MSME to receive the loans that I was discussing about, the collateral free loans. So I think these professionals are now a part of that definition. But I think that is also slightly hazy, whether, I mean, I have personally not come across a lawyer or law firm which has registered itself as an MSME, but I'll be happy to be corrected. But if you ask me, legally speaking, if I read the definition of enterprise, I think it says any other establishment engaged in providing or rendering of any service or services. So I think if you consider this definition, I think a law firm can also be registered as an MSME.
Okay. So the next question we have is, does a construction company need to register under MSME?
Again, there is no mandatory requirement to be registered as an MSME. If you fall under the definition of an enterprise, then any business can register itself. Of course, it says in any pertaining to any industry specified in the first schedule of the Industries Development and Regulation Act 1951. So if you fall under the said schedule, and if your business undertaking is not above the threshold for the medium enterprise, then definitely you can, you're providing both sale of goods and services as a builder. So I think you'll be covered under the definition of an enterprise.
Okay.
Vijay
has asked a question. If law firm can be registered in MSME, then why they are banned from advertising?
That is a different question altogether. It's a good question. Unfortunately, the bar is under the Advocates Act, so yeah. That hurdle will have to be crossed separately. But it's a good question, and I think that could maybe that could pave way for. I'm all for advertising. I think the whole idea was that it is a noble profession and one should not be advertising itself. But
sir,
I think in
but,
this day,
can I say something, sir?
Yeah, sure, of course.
Sir, according to me, एक law firm के अंदर जरूरी तो नहीं कि उसमें सारे advocates ही हो या lawyers ही हो by profession.
No, that's correct.
Right.
That's correct.
So there are people in law firm which are not advocates and not always talking about, but it's also about the company. Like they are in total providing a service which include
yes.
lawyer and
yes.
advocates' knowledge.
That's correct. That's correct.
So probably that is the reason that they can register under, you know, MSME and
Sure, that's a possibility. I agree with you. That could be a possibility, but otherwise also I think purely if there are three lawyers who have a law firm, they also, in my opinion, can register themselves as an enterprise. So even if there aren't other professionals, I think by themselves, they should also be able to register themselves.
Okay, so we are going to take this question as a last question for the session due to time constraints, sir. Ritika has asked, can a trader of finished goods be eligible for registration under MSME?
Can a trader of?
Finished goods.
Yeah, so that's a good question. So now, as per the definition of enterprise, it says any industrial undertaking, business concern or other establishment by whatever name called, engaged in the manufacture or production of goods. So you either must be engaged in the manufacture or the production of goods. So what happens to a trader or what happens to a person who purchases goods and then sells it off, or somebody who's not a producer or manufacturer of goods, then I think that person, although will not come under the definition of an enterprise, but will fall under the definition of a supplier. If you see, so that is 2E, which discusses an enterprise, but 2N talks of a supplier. And it says a supplier means a micro or small enterprise, which has filed a memorandum with the authority referred to in subsection 8, 1 of 8, and includes, and we come to C, it says any company, cooperative society, trust, or a body by whatever name called, registered or constituted under any law for the time being force and engaged in selling of goods produced by micro or small enterprise and rendering services which are provided by such enterprise. So the idea is that you yourself need not be an MSME, but if you are selling the goods produced by an MSME or manufactured by an MSME, you will fall under the definition of a supplier. So I believe you, a trader, might not be an MSME by itself, but it could come under the definition of a supplier. And that supplier need not itself be an MSME. It could be a large scale company also. So it need not be a medium enterprise also. It could be somebody whose threshold is higher than that, but who then sells, is a trader of goods which are produced by an MSME. So that I think is probably the answer that the query is looking for.
Okay. With this, due to time constraint, we won't be able to take all the questions. So I request, sir has shared his personal email ID. So
sure.
You can just mail him, you know, your queries, and so we'll be happy to help you guys, all the participants. So I would like to thank you, sir, for sharing such a wonderful insights. Like there were so many points which... I don't have a legal background though, but there are so many information which I have get from this today's webinar. So I would
I'm
like
glad.
To thank you so much, sir. I would
thank
like
you.
To thank all the participants who joined us to, today for the session. And last but not the least, I would like to thank Lawyer for giving us an opportunity.
Yes, definitely.
To you know come up with such an unique concept for MSMEs and e-commerce, which very few people talk about and like to cater these problems.
Thank you.
So any last word from your side, sir?
No, I think as far as I've come across, I have a lot of clients who are such small businesses, and I've seen that the issues that they generally face, and the issues really are with regards to how do you get back your money is a simple question that has been asked, and the problem really is that once you go into litigation, it takes a lot of time and a lot of money is expended, a lot of time is consumed, and the principal money that is a subject matter of the dispute that gets stuck. So I think that is something that this act, I think MSME Act, tries to deal with, and I think that read that along with the Commercial Courts Act, then your Arbitration and Conciliation Act, I think these all together, I think, have now given another additional forum for such businesses to have their disputes adjudicated. I mean, earlier the good old district courts or the civil courts were the only way out for these enterprises. I think now that these new legislations have come out, they require the most important thing is the implementation. I think on paper they are sound, they're logical, they seem beneficiary, but if the implementation is not correct, then that becomes a problem. So I think yes, the implementation is the most essential.
Thank you so much. There are a lot of participants thanking you and thanking you for the information. They have shared their thoughts privately to me as I am the host, sir. So
okay. Yeah, yeah, I was trying to see if I can see the chat, but I'm not. It's not accessible. Anyway, thank you so much. Yeah. It was a lovely experience. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir. Have a good evening and have a good great weekend ahead.